Thank you very much for the invitation. Yeah, so I would like to talk today on GIT quotients. And symplectic data analysis. So this is joint with Dayung Hall. And Agustin Moreno. And I will also use some previous work jointly with Peter Albers and Otto von Kort. So Albers. So let us first start with a real symplectic manifold. So what's a real symplectic manifold? So you know what the symplectic manifold is. This is W omega. And real is, so we have additional structure, namely we have an additional antisymplectic involution. So rho star of omega is minus omega, and it's an involution. Rho square is the identity. And the fixed point set of such an antisymplectic involution, this is a Lagrangian, where it might be possible that the Lagrangian is empty. So at empty set, we also think, if you allow the empty set to be a Lagrangian, then it's always a Lagrangian. Yes, yeah, so the standard example which explains the notion of real is you take here Cn with standard symplectic structure, and then antisymplectic involution is just complex conjugation, and then the fixed point set is the real vector space. So, and then we assume in addition that we have Hamiltonian from W to R, and the Hamiltonian we assume to be invariant. H of rho is H. And then for the Hamiltonian vector field, we have the Hamiltonian vector field defined implicitly and as usual. And then because H is invariant, but omega is anti-invariant, so the Hamiltonian vector field is anti-invariant as well. So we have the pullback of XH equals minus XH. And then this implies that for the flow, the flow is, if you look at the flow of the of this Hamiltonian vector field, so we have rho, so we have phi t h, the flow of Hamiltonian vector field, this equals rho phi minus t h rho. So the flow is conjugated to its inverse by the antisymplectic involution. So that is something one calls strongly reversible. So strongly reversible. So reversible means that map is the inverse of the map is conjugated to the map, and strongly means that this conjugation can be written down with an involution, and we are somehow very strongly because our involution has additional properties, namely it is antisymplectic. So this is a real symplectic manifold, and now if we have a real symplectic manifold, we can study symmetric periodic orbits. So So what is a symmetric periodic orbit? So maybe let's make a picture. So here is L. See, here is the fixed point set of our antisymplectic involution. So this should not be empty anymore, otherwise we don't have any symmetric periodic orbits. And our periodic orbit starts at this fixed point set. So this is x0 is here. And then it will come back to our fixed point set at the later time. So let's say it comes back at time tau over 2, tau, some positive number, and it satisfies the Hamiltonian equation. And then we can just continue like this. So we reflect our so from time zero to time tau over two, we have a chord. We have a chord from this Lagrangian to itself, and then we just reflect this chord via this anti-symplectic involution. And what we get is a periodic orbit. So that's a symmetric periodic orbit. So a symmetric periodic orbit somehow shares both. This, you can think of it as a closed string, namely as a periodic orbit, but you can also interpret it as an open string, namely it's completely determined by the chord from the Lagrangian back to itself. And now suppose we have such a symmetric periodic orbit. Now let's look at the monodromy of this symmetric periodic orbit. So we let's maybe abbreviate by C. Let's suppose C is the energy. C is the energy of this periodic orbit. So we have sigma is the energy hypersurface on which this symmetric periodic orbit lives. And then we have the differential of the flow of H at x0. So this is in your map from tangent space to itself, because it flow is autonomous, so the flow direction is just eigen vector to eigenvalue one. So we can this induces a map on the quotient x zero sigma mod out direction of the Hamiltonian vector field. So this is the monodromy, and this is actually symplectic. So this is symplectic. And on this vectors, we also have the anti-symplectic involution also keeps, so H is invariant under the anti-symplectic involution. So the anti-symplectic involution also keeps this tangent space invariant, and it maps Hamiltonian vector field to its inverse. So it also induces an involution on this quotient, which is antisymplectic as well. So we have here, in addition, an antisymplectic involution induced from the differential of our symplectic involution. And now this strong reversibility we have here translates to a strong reversibility on the linear level for monodromy and this linear antisymplectic involution. So we have then I equals M inverse. Now, so you Now we can ask, is this very restrictive for simple? So yeah, it looks like a nice equation. So is this very restrictive for a symplectic matrix to satisfy such a strong reversibility condition? So in particular, one could ask, so statements one has about the spectrum of symplectic matrices. So is this maybe when we have this strong reversibility, does this affect the spectrum? Or maybe you have heard from SFT that in SFT there are so-called bad periodic orbits. So then you could ask, so can it happen that maybe these symmetric periodic orbits are so nice that they are never bad? So that's question, how restrictive is this condition? And it's actually not so restrictive. That's a bit surprising. And this goes back to a theorem which I always find quite interesting. This is a theorem by Maria Wonnenberger. So let me tell you this theorem of Wonnenberger and then discuss what we can learn of it for our monodromy matrix of our symmetric periodic orbit. So Wonnenberger's theorem. Suppose we have symplectic vector space, finite dimensional symplectic vector space, and we have M from B to itself a linear symplectic. Then the theorem asserts that we can find two antisymplectic involutions, two linear antisymplectic involutions, so that our symplectic linear symplectic transformation can be written as a product of these two antisymplectic involutions. So that there exist I1, I2. B to itself linear antisymplectic involutions such that M can be written as the product of these two involutions. So as a consequence of this, we get some kind of strong reversibility for our symplectic map. Namely, let's see, so consequence. So because I1 and I2 are involutions, so that that means that the inverse and inverse we obtain just by interchanging just commuting I2 and I1. So M inverse is just I2, I1, because they are involutions. So if you have I1, I2, I2, I1. So the I2 cancel in the middle, and then the I1 cancel. And now I can, because I1 is involution, so I write this as I1, I1, I2, I1. So I just added an identity. And now we see here M again. So we have I1, M. So you see that on the such a linear symplectic map is always strongly reversible with respect to an antisymplectic involution. And now, so here we have a very specific antisymplectic involution, namely the one which comes from the differential of our nonlinear symplectic involution on the manifold. But on the linear level, all antisymplectic involutions are always conjugated to each other. So we can, after conjugation, we can actually assume that this I1 is the standard antisymplectic involution. So if you have V identified with standard symplectic vector space Rn times Rn, and I is just one, so the standard antisymplectic involution, so there's N, and then so if I1 from V to itself is antisymplectic involution, then you can find G symplectic linear symplectic map such that I1 is conjugated to this standard antisymplectic involution. And so if we apply this to M, to our M was the product of I1 and I2. So if we apply this conjugation to M, so M was I1, I2, so this is G inverse, G inverse, and so this is I, and this is a new antisymplectic. So we can, after conjugation, we can actually assume that our matrix is strongly reversible with respect to our given anti-symplectic involution. So you see that this question, if this monodromy, if there are some obstructions to the spectrum of the monodromy of for symmetric periodic orbit, there is no obstruction on the spectrum, since every linear symplectic map is conjugated to such a strongly reversible one with respect to I. And so there is also that does not give you any obstruction for symmetric periodic orbits to be bad. So they can also become bad. So let us abbreviate. So let us abbreviate SPI to N. These are all symplectic matrices which are strongly reversible with respect to our standard antisymplectic involution I. Maybe it's a funny thing to play with this involution. So suppose we have an element here in this SPI. So then if you look at M inverse I square, so M inverse I square, this is an inverse. I and inverse I, and now we plug in this M inverse. This is I and I. So here we have I and I. So I was involution, so it cancels. So we have M inverse M, and so this is the identity. So this M inverse I automatically gets an involution from this strong reversibility condition. And you see that if we have a matrix which satisfies this, then we can then if we write M as I M inverse I, so you see we can automatically write it as the product of these two antisymplectic involutions, where the first one is this I. So we have always, every after conjugation, every symplectic matrix can be brought into this form. But if you have symmetric periodic orbit, then this is somehow done automatically for us. Then the monodromy matrix will be automatically in this form for I, given by the differential of our nonlinear antisymplectic involution. So what I would like to discuss is that if we have this such Bohnenburger decomposition, such a description of our symplectic matrix as a product of two antisymplectic involutions, then this actually helps us to analyze the so this in general. If you look at this monodromy matrix, these are big matrices, and it's hard to immediately get information of it. But if we have this Bohnenburger decomposition, this helps us to somehow to analyze the data we have in this monodromy matrix. Namely, the first, let us write such our symplectic matrix in block form A, B, C, D, or n times n matrices A, B, C, and D. And if m is in SPI, so first you learn if it's symplectic, you have some conditions on A, B, and C, D. But if it's in SPI, we have much stronger conditions on these blocks. Namely, if you work this out, so you get the following equation. So first, E and the C both, they have to be symmetric. The D is just the transpose of A. And A and B almost commute, but not quite. So we have AB equals B A transpose, and A transpose C equals CA. And then finally, we have the determinant condition, but because D is just A transpose, this determinant condition, this becomes simplified. So A squared minus BC is identity. And so in the following, we don't need actually this D, because D is just A transpose. So I will just write here A transpose. So I don't need this condition here anymore. And let's call this A, B, C. Now I on this space, this SPI, I still have an action, and I have an action of the general linear group, and this has a geometric origin. If you think back how we came up with our monodromy matrix, namely we have this linear antisymplectic involution, and this gives a splitting. Namely, we have the eigenspaces, eigenspace to eigenvalue one, and eigenspace eigenvalue minus one. This is a Lagrangian splitting, and to choose a compatible symplectic basis, we have to choose a basis on one of these Lagrangians, and the choice of the basis is here we have this GLN freedom. So we have on this space we have an action by GLN, and is this so if R is in GLN, so I have this R star of on AEC. So AEC, these are now, yeah, it should satisfy these equations. So R star acts as, so A is just conjugated by R. and B and C transform as bilinear forms, namely B transforms as R, B, R transpose, and C transforms as R, P inverse, C, R inverse. And then, so for this action, so we have the, if we look at this, the matrix for the transformed ABC transformed via R, R, then this is, so we have R, R, R transpose inverse. We have this action of A, B, C, A transpose, R inverse, 0, 0, R. Now, the first thing one can work out is the following little lemma, namely, so the spectrum. So the spectrum of this MABC, this is actually completely determined by this first block A. So if so, for this B and C, they actually have no influence on the spectrum of such a symplectic matrix. So we have lemma. So we have so M is P is the characteristic polynomial, of E C. This is completely determined actually by the characteristic polynomial of 2A, but is equals Tn. P minus 2a minus t minus 1 over. Just from reversibility of symplectic matrix of symplectic matrix follows that the characteristic polynomial is always a palindrome. And because there's this, we already know that it's a palindrome, and for a palindrome, you can always find another pole. So this has degree 2n, but if because it's palindromic, we can find a polynomial of degree n, so that we can express this palindromic polynomial of degree 2n via this polynomial of tn with tn t plus 1 over t. And in this case, this other polynomial is precisely the characteristic polynomial of minus 2a. So we see as the spectrum is completely determined by A. So B and C have nothing to do with the spectrum, but you know that a symplectic matrix has more invariants than just its spectrum. So you know that there is something like crime theory, and which gives you additional information on the spectrum, and additional information, additional invariant on the symplectic map, independent, additional to the spectrum. And we can, so we here we can also get additional information, additional invariant using B the following way. So we have additional invariant so suppose that lambda in R is a simple eigenvalue of A. And yeah, and then it's as well as so A and A transpose have the same spectrum. So it's also simple eigenvalue of A transpose. So suppose that V is an eigenvector. Eigenvalue lambda for A transpose B equals lambda B. Then we have additional, so we can look at the sign of we apply B to B and B transpose. So this, so because a simple eigenvalue, this is determined up to a scaling, but this, so the scaling just gives a scaling square gives is just a positive number. So this sign does not depend on V, just on the eigenvector, only on the eigenvalue, and in view of this transformation behavior of A and B under the R action, this additional invariant, this is an invariant under this R action. So this is invariant under any action. Only depends on lambda. So this GLN action, this is an additional choice we have to do, and we actually would like to have to see something independent of this choice. So now. So what one can try is to look at the quotient space of SPI modulo GLN. But so this quotient space is a kind of a terrible space. So this is not hard to see to analyze the data in this quotient space. So that's why we do something else. And we don't look at the usual quotient space, but we look at the GIT quotient. So let me explain you next what we mean with a GIT quotient. Thank you. So GIT quotient. So we have N as a manifold, and we have G V group. And yeah, usually not compact Lie group, to be interesting, not compact. And we define relation on this manifold, that is orbit closure relation. So define the following relation. So you say two points X, Y in N, they are related. Closures their orbits on G intersect. They are not, that is this, the intersection of the closures is not empty. So we don't require that the orbits themselves intersect, but the closures should intersect. So this relation, this is it's obviously reflexive. X is related to X, and it's obviously also symmetric. So it's reflexive and symmetric. And if it's so, transitivity is not it's not so obvious, not clear in general. But if it's also transitive, we are happy, because then we have an equivalence relation, and then we can consider the equivalence classes. So if, in addition, this relation is transitive, then define N mod G, and this is just N, so the equivalence classes under this orbit closure relation. That is GIT quotient. So let us look at an example. So we have the n real n times n matrices, and we have the action by GLn by conjugation, and then this GIT. So the usual quotient is kind of terrible because of all this Jordan forms. But if we GIT quotients basically avoids Jordan factors. Then namely, if we have this GIT quotient, this is just Rn, namely, if we have a matrix, n times n matrix, so we look at its characteristic polynomial. So this is times bn, an minus 1, bn minus 1 plus a 0, and we map this class to an minus 1, n minus 2, a 0. So we just the map from to the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial gives us identification of this GIT quotient with Ra. And Now, let's go back to the story of the symplectic matrices. So we have on SP2N, so SP2N also acts on itself by conjugation. So we have action of SP2N on itself by conjugation. And now we have this SP, this I reversible symplectic matrices N. On this we have the action by GL. So we have this GIT quotient, and but by Wollenberger, every symplectic matrix is actually conjugated to one herein. So we actually have surjective map to SP to the GIT quotient of SP2N, where SP2N acts by itself via conjugation. And so if we have here we have our matrix A, B, C, and if we map this matrix just to the class of A, then this here lies in the GIT quotient of the matrices modulo GLN. So this is on R. So let me illustrate this picture in the easiest possible case, namely in the case n equals 1. So example for n equals 1. So n equals 1, SP2, this is actually just SL2. And SPI of 2. These are the only condition we have, so that the blocks are now 1 times 1 matrices, so these are just numbers. So we have A, B, C, but then the condition we have is that D equals A. So usually we have D transpose this A, but now just number. So if the matrix is A, B, C, A, and then we have the determinant condition A square minus C is 1. Yeah. So actually this somehow goes back to Darwin. George Darwin was an astronomer, and he noticed this one for this symmetric periodic orbits. That's always D equals A. So now let us make this picture. So let's just write this picture. Well, how does this look like? And so this is S GL1 so it is just scaling and then we have here SP GIT quotient of SP2 acting by itself by conjugation, and then we have here the R and to R. So what you do, so if you have here so here we have this such an A, E, C, A. So here we might just map to A, to this first. And so actually we just map to half of the trace. And so because this has determined one, then you already see that. So that in this easiest example, you see that the trace completely determines the spectrum. So for this picture, I should actually for here, I should all actually work also mention some Beja Cho, which I think it was the first to describe this GIT quotient here for SPI of GL1. So here this is just a spectrum. Then maybe let's look here first for the symplectic matrices. Here is two circles. This is the elliptic part. So here is minus one and here is one. And then we have here matrix cosine theta minus sine theta sine theta cosine theta. So it doesn't need to be necessary, but it's this is canonical representative in this in the equivalence class here. And here above we have cosine theta sine theta minus sine theta cosine. So here we have here in the elliptic part we have these two branches and they are distinguished by this sign I discussed before, and you see this corresponds precisely to the crime value to the crime number of this eigenvalue. And then in the symplectic part, in the hyperbolic case, we don't have this additional invariant, but in the real case we have. And so we have here we have a canonical representative cosine hyperbolic cos of theta sine hyperbolic cos of theta sine hyperbolic cos of theta cosine hyperbolic cos of theta, and here we have cosine hyperbolic cos theta minus sine hyperbolic cos of theta minus sine hyperbolic cosine hyperbolic cos of theta, and here we have we have replaced cosine by minus cosine. so this is the picture and the easiest case n equals one. And now in the last 5 minutes, let me discuss some applications of these pictures to the bifurcation analysis of periodic orbits. So before this bifurcation analysis, let me just make some general remarks. So if you have periodic orbit, not necessarily symmetric, then for at any time t, we can look at the monodromy at xt, but all these monodromy maps, they are symplectically conjugated by the soul. So if we look at the equivalence class here in sp2n, mode mode sp2n, this is independent of the point, and this is independent of t. But if we have symmetric periodic orbit, this, so we have here x0 and x power 2, then at these two points, if you just look at the monodromy matrix in this GIT quotient, they are obviously the same, but we have refined. We have this higher one, this real one. And so question is, when we look here at the monodromy matrix of x0 and power 2 in SPI Ln, are these matrices, are they the same or not? They are the same here, but on this final invariant, it's not obvious. And they actually don't need to be. And to discuss an example where they are not the same, and we can actually get some information from this final invariant on the bifurcation is, if you look at the period W. So that's the following. We start with so we have elliptic periodic orbit with a family of orbits. So this family was first elliptic, and then it gets a negative hyperbolic. So then a simple orbit, we don't get the degenerate, but the double cover of this orbit gets degenerate. And here a new periodic orbit comes out. This has a double period. It's like this. So now let us suppose we are in a symmetric case. We are in a symmetric case, like this. And because my blackboard is just two-dimensional, I should discuss this in a four-dimensional space. So I use the phase space of my blackboard. So the Lagrangian is actually the conormal of this. So to hit the Lagrangian, I have here, I need to have here right angle. Now, if it just go once around, then we can interpret this also as a chord. We start here at the Lagrangian, go back to the Lagrangian. And this again, this as well, this is also. Now, what could happen? Either this chord could get degenerate and bifurcate, or this chord could get degenerate. So let's suppose this chord degenerates. Then, so we have here. We get a new chord. So here we don't hit the Lagrangian anymore. I don't make right angle. So now this chord was degenerating, and then we can reflect this at using the antisymplectic involution, and we get this periodic orbit. Or if we get degenerate here, or we get degenerate here. But if you get degenerate, so one is degenerate and one is not degenerate. So that one can work out with the signs. So at one point the signs will change, at one point it will not change. And using the sign change, you can predict where this new orbit will occur, either here or here. Okay, so that was it. So now I stop. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Urs, for the really nice talk. Any questions?
So what kind of general applications you have in mind going forward?
Yes. Exploring ocean worlds around Jupiter. So here is the following. So around Jupiter there is Europa, and it's, so actually that Dayung Ko is here. So she's JPL, and she's working for JPL. Engineers, so she knows much better about these stories. But maybe Dayung can correct me. But Jupiter has a moon. This is Europa, and Europa, there is ice on it, but below the ice there is water, and maybe there is life in this water. So Europa is a very interesting moon. One should definitely explore. But now, if you want to send a mission around Europa, so this you should have a spatial orbit, namely when your satellite is in the plane. Then it's very hard to communicate with this satellite. So you would like to have an orbit which goes out of the plane and goes in space. And now there is the question: how do you actually find spatial orbits in the restricted free body problem?
So similar like what you guys found for the moon, go up and down and up and down and up.
But now Dayung and her collaborators they have another approach, and so what they do, they actually start planar, because you know planar orbits very well, so you have the retrograde and the direct and retrograde. So these are planar orbits, but you can interpret them in also as spatial orbits, as special spatial orbits, and as them they have two Floer multipliers, namely one a spatial one and a planar one. Now, if the spatial one goes to a root of unity, then a spatial bifurcation happens. And so this kind of bifurcations is Dayung is studying. And yeah, so, so in this talk, to simplify a bit, the picture I made basically on for the planar case, for the two-dimensional case, but actually this, so with his paper with Augustin, what we did is we, in much detail, we discussed this story for in the 4x4 case, because this 4x4 case, this is actually the one relevant for this spatial periodic orbits. So this is what you this is what one needs to understand to for these bifurcations of periodic orbits in space.
Okay. Yeah, by the way, very nice talk. So but I wonder, so this guy is doing representation theory, so they never figured out something like this? This Wonnenberger theorem is some kind of industry, works in many groups, I think. Yeah, in many groups you have representations of maps by involutions and so on. So that seems to be.
This itself is a quite interesting story. So when can you write a map as a product of two involutions? Mm-hmm. Strong reversibility.
I mean, I never saw anything like this, so it's clearly some interesting structure.
In the 4x4 case, it's quite interesting, like the bifurcation locus that you have on the plane. Presumably, there's also some interesting structure for the high dimensional cases, but we didn't do it. It looks like, well, I guess you would expect it to be quite complicated in your algebra. Mm-hmm. But not, I mean, probably doable, right? Urs,
yeah? So what you see here also, that there are definitely interesting connections to a symmetric space theory, because this SPI is actually a symmetric space. Because SPI, every map here, we can write as II, where II is a linear antisymplectic involution. So you just forget I and map this to II, and then you're in the space of antisymplectic involutions. And this is a symmetric space, because if you have two of them, I1 and I2, so this I1 and I, so we have a this product, this in this symmetric space word, this is, you conjugate one involution by the other involution. This corresponds to this geodesic involution on this symmetric spaces. Yeah, so there is definitely a lot of connections also to symmetric space theory.
Could you please repeat down to earth? So what is the relation between period doubling and your GIT picture? I missed somehow this point.
So you want to see this here?
Yes. So how it's related to the previous part?
Right. So you have here this. So you see here this elliptic becomes negative hyperbolic, and now. A new period orbit of double period has to appear, and the question is, where shall we look for this new world? And now if this orbit was symmetric, then we have more clues where to look for it. Namely, there are basically, because now we have this, we can also think of this, we have both, we have open string and closed string interpretation. So let's now first look at the open string bifurcation, which we'll have. So if we have, so the simple orbit here, this is as well a chord, the chord starting and ending here. Now, if this chord bifurcates, then we have this picture. So we get a new chord. So this new chord will not be periodic anymore. It will go like this. But if we apply the antisymplectic involution, we again have a periodic orbit of double period. So this is if the open string here is degenerate. If it's degenerate here, we get a different picture. And we have a chord like this. Then, if you reflect, you get periodic orbit like this. So now, if you want to find this new one, this red one, so you want to figure out, is it this or this picture? And to find it, if you know it's this, then to find it, you can start shooting here perpendicularly. Or you can start shooting here perpendicularly. So you would like to know, is it this picture or is it this picture? And now we have this refined invariant. So we have this additional sign. And this additional sign we can study here. We study this additional sign here for this negative hyperbolic one. And this additional sign is different at x zero and at x tau over two, depending in which situation you are. And so if it's here negative, you will have this picture. If it's here negative, you will have this picture. So this additional invariant tells you where you have to look for your new periodic orbit of double period.
Okay. Does this? Yes, so that's it. Thank you. And is there any way to include this into some Floer theory? So
yeah, right. So that's because what one definitely so one has local Floer homology.
Yes.
So we have local Floer homology. So the local Floer homology before and after bifurcation has to be has to coincide. So local Floer homology doesn't jump. And actually, and so the simple thing we can look up look at is just the Euler characteristic. And this Euler, so this is kind of this SFT Euler characteristic we have. And let us look here at this at the SFT Euler characteristic before and after bifurcation. So we want to look for this local SFT Euler characteristic for the double one. For the simple one, no bifurcation actually happens, but for the double one. So for this SFT Euler characteristic, for this double one, this is elliptic, so it's minus one. Now here the double cover of a negative hyperbolic is a so-called bad periodic orbit. So bad periodic orbits don't contribute to SFT. So this doesn't contribute. So a new periodic orbit has to occur, this also has to be elliptic because this SFT Euler characteristic has to stay minus one. But now we have, in addition, if we are symmetric, we have not just the usual SFT, but we have also the real Floer homology. So we can also study this from the point of view of chords. And so what you see, we have. So here we'll have actually four chords involved, namely, so we have this chord here. Then we have this chord here. And here we have this chord and the green chord. And now there is to compute this Euler characteristics, you have to know the indices. So what you have to know is that if you go here once around and here once around, does the index jump or does not jump? And this. Now we have two indices, namely we have the Condi-Sander index and we have the Maslow index. So their difference, this is the so-called Hermander index. And this invariant, this tells about Hermander index. And so this invariant tells, so you see that the Condi-Sander index here jumps by one. So the question is, does here the Maslow index jump by one, or does it here jump by one? And if it also jumps by one, then the Hermander index has to be zero. And this you can figure out with this invariant. Or if it does jump here by one, here the Hermander index is zero and here it is one. So this invariants I told that they are related to the Hermander index, and so therefore for the difference of the open string Euler characteristics and the closed string Euler characteristics.
Interesting.
So let me ask a completely stupid question. Could there be This is what you do is linear, but could there be some trace in the nonlinear theory of this on some level?
This reversibility, this is a bit different project. So is Egor looking here? Because Wollenborg tells you that at the linear level, you can always write a linear symplectic map as a product of linear antisymplectic involutions. Now, you can ask the same thing, of course, for the nonlinear case.
But that looks presumably a little bit too optimistic. But I could still imagine that you can go into, on some level, into the nonlinear terrain. No? But maybe ignore me
there is the whole theory of reversible systems, right? So, for instance, I know that Kolmogorov-Arnold-Moser theory is pushed pretty much for reversible systems. So there are people who are doing this for a living.
What I don't understand is that linear stuff I just saw wasn't really in the public mind. Yeah. I would be surprised if there's something in the nonlinear terrain which we didn't know on the linear level.
Right.
I mean, there's something I don't understand, so philosophically.
As I agree that there are many philosophical questions. So maybe I can talk about this bit, this different question. I agree that this may be a bit too optimistic any Hamiltonian diffeomorphism is product of two antisymplectic involutions. But what you can ask, so how many do you need? This is very much related to this stuff. So how many antisymplectic involutions you need? You have some channel Hamiltonian diffeomorphism, and then you were asking R1, S1, R2, S2, Rn, Sn. How many do you need that you can recover your Hamiltonian diffeomorphism? And actually, what is true, you can always do it with finitely many. This is related to the Abanyava theorem, that the simpleness of the Hamiltonian of this Hamiltonian diffeomorphism group. But then you have finitely many, but then you can ask and you can define a metric, a bi-invariant metric on this Hamiltonian diffeomorphism group, and then you can ask has this finite or infinite diameter? So I think this is more the generalization of this Wollenborg theorem I see at the moment to the nonlinear case. Or do you have other suggestions, Helen?
No, I'm in awe now. But it looks really interesting. Yeah, well, some work to be done.
Yeah, there's a lot of work to do.
How finite diameter if we have non-trivial quasimorphisms on Hamiltonian?
This is very much related to this quasimorphisms. But so at the moment this quasi-morphism worked very well for symplectic involutions. Also for symplectic involutions, you can get infinite diameter, but it always so far it always fails with anti-symplectic ones.
Okay, thank you.
And so what? So the question I have, and which I don't know really the answer, is this maybe just because we are a bit too stupid, or is this really a phenomenon? And very elementary geometry. So very elementary geometry. So you have you can look at point reflections and line reflections. And now any isometry in the plane you can obtain by two line reflections. Any orientation preserving is a product of two line reflections. But if you do point reflections, you only get translation. So you don't get all isometries. This topic was a topic which was once extremely much studied. It was especially studied that the books are mostly in German. So for example, Bachmann is Aufweiter Geometrie aus dem Spiegelungsbegriff. So you want to construct geometry out of reflections. And this goes back to Hilbert, because Hilbert told you instead of lines and points, we should just say chairs, tables, and beer mugs. And Helmslev said instead of point, we say point reflection, and instead of line, we say line reflection. And this generated a huge industry of studying this, so you could algebraize all this stuff. And the picture somehow I have in mind that there might be a generalization of this elementary geometry to symplectic geometry, so that these anti-symplectic involutions, they somehow play the role of the points, they play the roles of the lines, and symplectic involutions, they play the point, that the role of the points. So this is more the broader picture I would think is behind the story in the nonlinear case.
Great.
Well, now one more problem to worry about. God, I've guessed on the data.
There are many problems to worry. Yes.
Super.
Thank you very much.
So thank you, Urs, again for the very nice talk.